Morning. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to worship on this Sunday morning. Am I sounding loud? Can you turn that down, please? I thought I was sounding loud. Well, welcome to worship. We're really glad you're here and want to say a special welcome to visitors both here and online. Let's give a wave to our online people. Welcome to worship. We're glad that you're here. As always, I have just a couple of announcements. What's Up Wednesday for the month is going to be this coming Wednesday at noon. There'll be a link for that in your email, so we'll hope you will join us. I know lots and lots of people are on vacation right now, but if you'd like to join us, we'd love to see you. Also, just a couple announcements about volunteer opportunities. We're still looking for ushers for this service, and we're looking for sound people for, wave to the sound people. Hello. Is it hard, sound people? No, it's not hard. Was that a yes or no? No, it's good. It really is just a button, they tell me. Even I could do it. So we're looking for sound people for both this service and the contemporary service. We want to make sure that when we start in the fall that both services can be seen online. So if you're willing to just take a stab at it, let us know, let me know, and I'll get you in touch with the right people. And now as we enter into worship, let us take a deep breath of the Spirit and let us worship God.
I invite you to join me in our call to worship this morning. We gather today seeking the peace that Christ gives. We gather in spite of many a conflict, many a doubt within our souls. We gather longing for the breath of God's Spirit to give us courage and renewal. Come, Christ Jesus, be our guest. Bless us through the power of your Spirit. And give us courage to live as your disciples day by day. Let us worship God.
The proof of God's amazing love is this. While we were sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare to approach God with confidence. So, trusting in God's grace, let's join together in saying the prayer of confession as printed in the bulletin. God, you have called us to live lives worthy of the calling to which we have been called. But we confess to you and each other that we have not always spoken the truth in love. We have not always made an effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Forgive us, and by your grace, help us grow in every way into Him who is our head, Jesus Christ. Amen. Hear the good news. If we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. The first scripture this morning is from Psalm 78, verses 23 through 29. If you'd like to follow along, it's in the Old Testament, page 538. Hear the word of the Lord. Yet he commanded the skies above and opened the doors of heaven. He rained down on them manna to eat and gave them the grain of heaven. Mortals ate of the bread of angels. He sent them food in abundance. He caused the east wind to blow in the heavens, and by his power he led out the south wind. He rained flesh upon them like dust, winged birds like the sand of the seas. He let them fall within their camp and all around their dwellings. And they ate and were well filled, for he gave them what they craved. Here ends the first lesson.
Thank you, Chris and Allison. Indeed, our God is great. Our gospel lesson this morning is taken from John chapter 6, verses 24 to 35. You can find it on page 98 in your New Testament Pew Bibles if you'd like to read along this morning. Hear God's word as it comes to us from John. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him who he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, 'He gave them bread from heaven to eat.'" Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." This is the word of the Lord. Please join me in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the opportunity to come together and worship this morning, both here and for those who are worshiping with us online. We are thankful that your word speaks to us across the generations, and by the power of your Holy Spirit, you inspire us as your disciples to act out with faith and hope and belief. So, Lord, we ask that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts would be acceptable in your sight. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. The Gospel of John is an amazing gospel, and we've been looking at it for the last few weeks, and this is something that caught my eye right away. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into their boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. And I think that's maybe the first part of discipleship, is simply making a decision to look for Jesus. Where can Jesus be found? And for us in the life of the church, sometimes we take it for granted that Jesus is in all those familiar places that we expect here at worship, or maybe at a special ceremony, at a wedding, or a baptism. But we forget that Christ fills our whole world with love and with life. And that's what Jesus is talking about when he's talking about bread from heaven. The disciples that were following him were remembering the story about Moses and how they were fed manna in the wilderness. And Jesus was saying, no, that wasn't from Moses, that was from your God in heaven. And he was challenging them to receive the kind of bread from heaven that God had prepared for them. So it made me ask the question, where in the world is Jesus? Especially when we think about the sacrament of the Lord's Supper that we're going to partake in together as a family of faith. It made me think about a recent lecture I was listening to by a Catholic priest who was lecturing about their understanding of the sacrament at a conference. And one of his concerns was that 70% of Roman Catholics in America don't believe with their understanding of theology at the Eucharist. So I thought it's okay for me to use a little teaching moment to talk about theology. Now, I know when I first did my first call to preach at a church in Maryland, and it was for the PNC, the call committee was there, and I suggested to them it was time for a little bit of Calvin And everyone, I could hear the groan in the congregation. But fortunately, I was giving an illustration about Calvin and Hobbes and not John Calvin, right? But this morning, I'm going to go right to the theology. He was concerned that 70% of Roman Catholics didn't believe in transubstantiation, as if that the body and blood of Christ are real on this table. Well, as Presbyterians, let's review our Reformed theology. And for me, this is really important. You'll never hear me call this the altar, because it's not. There's no sacrificial mass happening for us at the Lord's Supper, right? This is a communion table. It's a table where we gather around in fellowship. It's a table for all that Christ welcomes to his table. It's a table of fellowship. It's a table of love. It's a table of commitment. It's a table of saying, Lord, we appreciate your sacrifice on the cross. So for us, we have the regular cross, not a crucifix, because Jesus has been raised from the dead. And we don't believe that this is truly the body and blood of Christ, somehow magically transforming the bread and the wine or the grape juice into the body and blood of Christ. So what do we mean? Well, Lutherans said it's a little bit of both, right? They talked about consubstantiation. They were talking about how it's really the body and blood of Christ, but at the same time, it's just bread and wine at the same time. Well, for the Reformers, John Calvin and others, this was a real issue. If Jesus died once and for all for our sins, why do we have to have a sacrificial mass where we call this an altar? It's confusing to people. So this morning, I want to remind us that we believe that these are ordinary elements set aside for sacred use. I remember in seminary, I did this big 45-page paper about communion, contrasting it with the Roman Catholicism and our understanding of what it means to be Reformed and Presbyterian. It was boring for you, I'm sure, but for me it was exciting because there wasn't internet in those days, and there were some great articles that I needed, but they were at the Vatican. Well, I got approval from my committee chair, my professor, and they teletyped all these papers to us at Princeton, and I was able to finish my paper. I was so happy about it. Now we just go on the internet and get whatever we want, right? But in those days, it was important for me to think about that because I came out of that Roman Catholic tradition. And I wanted to make sure that somebody said, how did we get this Roman Catholic? I wanted them to say, how did we get this Roman Catholic in the Presbyterian pulpit? So I spent some time doing that. And it was interesting for me to say, found out that these are ordinary elements set aside for sacred use. But it doesn't mean it's mere remembrance. We're not just remembering what happened 2,000 years ago. When Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me, he was being serious about our life of faith, that this could be an aid to our faith, to help us in our journey together as the people of God. So the real presence wasn't in the bread or the wine, but the real presence is that Christ is here with us as we break bread and as we celebrate this sacrament together. You know how the Apostle Paul talked about it? He said, for I received from the Lord what I also handed down to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. So when Presbyterians and Reformed people are talking about remembrance, it's just not remembering the past, but it's making it real in the present because Christ is present with us as we celebrate the sacrament. So here are ordinary elements of bread and wine set aside for this sacred sacrament, where we recognize what God has done for us in Jesus Christ, remembering that sacrifice on the cross once and for all for the forgiveness of our sins. And I think it's really important that we think about this in terms of bread from heaven. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. What did Jesus mean by that? I am the bread of life. I've been wrestling with that, not just in my journey of faith, but this past week as I prepared for my sermon. I was trying to think about that expectation, and it brought me back to this funny memory. I remember we had to play soccer at this field in North Fargo, and my wife and I were on this co-ed team, and we played together on this team for 13 years. But every time we were at that field at a certain time, I could smell the bakery. There was a huge bakery there, and they were baking all the bread for the next morning to sell. And I would be there, and I'd be starving because I wouldn't want to eat before a game, and I could smell that fresh bread. It drove me crazy. It made me wonder to think about, what does it mean when Jesus said to long for that bread that sustains you for eternal life? So where in the world is Jesus? I think Jesus is with us now. Christ is present with us as we celebrate the sacrament. For us, it's not in the bread, it's not in the wine, but Christ is spiritually present, and we're lifted up in the presence of Christ with one another, with all the saints that have gone before us. So this morning, if you're asking the question about, particularly about communion, I know you didn't come here this morning asking that question. What's the difference between transubstantiation and consubstantiation? I know you didn't, right? You were thinking of other things. But sometimes it's important for us to think about our theology. Theology is important. We come to the table, it's not an altar of sacrifice. It's a table of fellowship because Christ has already laid his life on the line for us and God has raised him to new life. It's a fellowship where we gather together as Presbyterians, as Christians around this world, celebrating what God has done for us in Jesus Christ. And as we take the cup and as we pass the bread, we make a commitment to remember just who Jesus is and what Jesus means for us in our lives today. Calvin and his Institutes, now not Calvin and Hobbes, this is the real John Calvin. He said it this way, "For the Lord so communicates his body to us that he is made completely one with us and we with him. Now, since he is only one body of which he makes us all partakers, it is necessary that all of us be made one body by such participation. The bread shown in the sacrament represents unity. As it is made of many grains so mixed together that one cannot be distinguished from another, so it is fitting that in the same way we should be joined and bound together by such a great agreement of minds that no sort of division may intrude." Interesting. Calvin is suggesting as we come to the table as a body of Christ, we are making a commitment to love one another. We are making a commitment to unity, to work for the good of the Church of Jesus Christ. So this morning, we might want to ask the question, where is Jesus? I would suggest wherever we find the bread of life, wherever we find that bread that is given to us from heaven, like manna out in the wilderness for the ancient Israelites, the bread of heaven is here for all of us, available to us at all times. So as we come to the table this morning, I want us to remember that this is a table of fellowship, it's a table of unity, it's a table of commitment, it's a table of remembrance, and it's a table of the real presence of Jesus Christ as he celebrates the sacrament with us. So as you're partaking in the bread and the wine, remember that Jesus is with us. Jesus is here by the power of the Holy Spirit. So where is Jesus? Jesus is right here as we have gathered in his name and as we celebrate this sacrament together. Amen.
other adults got to spend a week in the mountains at Montreat, at Montreat's youth conference. It was an absolutely incredible week. We played together, we sang together, we worshiped together. Sometimes we cried together, we laughed together. It was truly a transformational week. Because of your giving, we can do things like this. We can send 12 youth for a week away to grow closer together, not only to each other, but to God. And so I am so thankful for your faithful giving that allows things like this to happen. As a reminder, we are collecting our offering at the basket in the back. So if you'd like to leave a tithe and offering, that is where you can do it. And now let me pray for our offering. Holy God, thank you for the gifts that we receive. Thank you for these faithful people who give to this community, to our youth, and to the church universal. We thank you so much for their gifts. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
I'm so glad that Mick talked about theology today, because almost every time that I do the invitation to the bread, I talk about bringing all that is in your life, all that brings you great joy, and all those things that bring you uncertainty or sorrow. And I ask you to bring all those to the table, bring your whole self, knowing that our Lord Jesus meets us here. And so now we know that we meet the Lord Jesus, who is here spiritually with us as we partake in this meal. So I will remind you that as we partake in this meal, that indeed Jesus is here, and that we also take this meal with everyone in every time and place. So if you're thinking about your loved ones who have gone to heaven, you are taking this meal with them too. So I invite everyone to this meal, knowing that Jesus is here.
Please join me in a great prayer of thanksgiving as printed in your bulletin. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord, our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Holy God, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, with joy we praise you and give thanks to your name. You commanded light to shine out of darkness and divided the sea and dry land and created the vast universe and called it good. You made us in your image to live with one another. You gave us the breath of life and freedom to choose your way. You promised yourself in covenant with Abraham and Sarah and told us of your purpose in the commandments through Moses and called for justice in the cry of the prophets. Through long generations, you have been faithful and kind to all of your children. Great and wonderful are your works, Lord God Almighty. Your ways are just and true. Therefore, we lift our hearts in joyful praise, joining our voices with the choirs of angels, with the faithful of every time and place, who forever sing to the glory of your name. Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise you, most holy God, for sending your only Son to live among us, sharing our joy and sorrow. He told your story, healed the sick, and was a friend of sinners. Obeying you, he took up his cross and died that we might live. We praise you that he overcame death and has risen to rule the world. He is still the friend of sinners. We trust him to overcome every power that can hurt or divide us, and believe that when he comes in glory, we will celebrate victory with him. Remembering all your mighty and merciful acts, we break bread and share one cup, giving thanks for your saving love in Jesus Christ. As you raised our Lord from death and call us with him from death to life, we give ourselves to you to live for him in joy and grateful praise. So gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. Send us out by the power of your Spirit to live for others, as Christ lived for us, announcing his death for the sins of the world and telling his resurrection to people and nations. And by your Spirit, draw us together into one body and join us to Christ the Lord, that we may remain his glad and faithful people until we feast with him in glory. We ask this in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
On the night of his arrest, our Lord Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks, he blessed it and broke it and said, Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
Let us partake together. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. In the same way, after supper was ended, Jesus took the cup, and after giving thanks to God, he said, This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. Let us partake together. Let us join in our unison communion prayer. Let us pray. O God, you have so greatly loved us, long sought us, and mercifully redeemed us. Give us grace that in everything we may yield ourselves, our wills, and our works as a continual thank offering to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Sunday. We're getting a lot of traffic with our little pantry as well as with the food in our indoor pantry. So thank you for doing that, and stay tuned for next month, what we'll ask you to bring next month. Thank you for feeding others. Before Mick does the benediction, I wanted to ask for prayers for Tuck Wilson. Tuck is in Fairfax Hospital, so please pray for Tuck. I also want to ask for prayers for Diane Maloney, Paige's partner, who lost her grandmother this morning. So please pray for Paige and Diane and her family.
And I just want to say thank you, Paige, and all the advisors that went with to Montreat. I was loving watching the pictures come on Facebook and through some text. So thank you, Paige, for being faithful. It's so nice that I don't have to worry about that. They're in your great care and hands of your ministry, so thank you so much for that. I charge you now to go out into the world in peace, expecting always the unexpected, and anticipating miracles, knowing that with God, all things are possible. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and always. And all God's people say together, Amen.